politicians are thick-skinned. But the point that I'm making is that the situation may be very simple, but for him, he thinks that this is out of the way. This is something which I cannot manage. And he gets into...
Sorry, they don't get heart attacks, but they do get cancers.
That was due to the tobacco. Pan.
Also the
pan.
Pan.
Yeah. No, but what I'm trying to tell you is the situation where a person feels that it is getting out of his control, see, that is when the stress syndrome comes. You see? That is when tension comes. Yeah?
Yeah, supposing a person is
stuck. I'm a little deaf.
If a person is stuck into a fight or flight situation, okay, I think he can use the deep breathing techniques to come out of it. Maybe like 20 or 30 deep breathing.
Well, those techniques are relaxation techniques and other things. But basically, first, if you know what is causing, you can come out of it. Okay? So I'm trying to tell you, it's not just only heart attack. See, I'll come to that it is heart attack, diabetes, blood pressure, you know, all these diseases are stress related. And the basic reason is that we are not able to adjust. We are not able to, and there are simple things. I'm not going into, see, personally I don't believe too much in this cholesterol and fat and this and that, you see. So I'll come to that later on. But just now what I have told, I hope you have understood, that it is a situation where the feeling comes that I have no control. Things are going out of my hand. And whenever that feeling comes, the patient is likely to get a stress. Not the hard work. Again, I am repeating, if you are working 12 hours a day, if you are working 14 hours a day, but when you go home, you sleep well, you see, next day morning you get up with enthusiasm, that means you are fighting. See, you know that, okay, I have to do this work. And therefore, you aim at it and you work. You may succeed, you may not succeed. If you don't succeed, you change your plan. You see, you adapt, but you go on. In that case, you are not getting stress syndrome. But whenever you get, so the negative feelings, as I said, see, negative feelings are dangerous. The most important negative feeling, therefore, is fear. See, intense fear. The other one is frustration. So, when you feel lot of fear, you see, then you are bound to get into this sort of situation. You follow? So, these situations can come in different ways. One is very acute. Something happens suddenly. And that is where I told you that sympathetic, parasympathetic and the celiac axis spasm comes. And that is the first adaptation syndrome. But sometimes, and nowadays, the situation becomes chronic. It's not one day affair. For months together, 6 months, 8 months, you see, you are under the stress and stress. You see, I told you that in animals, they run away. When they run away, the heart comes down and they're okay. Now you can't run away and you can't do, and you are struggling. But you are feeling all the time helpless. Then that is the second stage of syndrome, you see, which is called as resistant or chronic stress. Now it is the chronic stress where this cortisol goes up. Some of you came a little late, but I told you that adrenal gland, so the cortisol goes up, see, body calm. From adrenaline, and adrenaline goes up. One is by cortex, one is medulla. You know, outer coat is called as cortex, and inside is called as medulla. The two are different. The cortex is what causes cortisone, and the medulla is what produces adrenaline. So, but the gland is one. See? Now this cortisone, therefore, is the one which increases sugar. And this adrenaline is the one which increases blood pressure. So you start getting diabetes or this. Or as I told you, that celiac axis, if that goes in spasm, suddenly the pancreatic cells die. No? Spasm. No? So the pancreatic cells which produce insulin start dying. See, they cannot produce insulin. So the insulin comes down. Yes? That's what I said. There is this kidney, and right above the kidney, right behind, you know, there is a gland like this. Now, because it is next to the kidney is renal, you see. Kidney is called renal. So this is adrenal, that means near renal, or suprarenal, that means above the kidney. See, so adrenal or suprarenal is this gland. Now this gland is actually made of two parts. This outer side, you see, is the one which produces cortisone. While this inner one, medulla, this is the one that causes adrenaline. You ask whether one. So it is one gland but not one function. There are two different functions by two different types of cells. But basically what I told right in the beginning, I think you came out late. I showed that there is one single vessel which supplies the stomach, the pancreas, the suprarenal, and the sympathetic and that system also affects the heart. So whenever there is some trouble with cortisone with sympathetic parasympathetic system, these are the organs which get affected. That is the heart, or ulcers, or pancreatic, therefore insulin reduction, diabetes, or adrenaline and this production, therefore hypertension.
But how is this connected from mind and
yes, mind is connected. That's why I said, no, the whole thing starts from here. Your fear or your frustration, any deep sensation, negative feelings, you see, are the cause. What about anger? Because everybody tells, don't get angry. See, don't get. Now, that is a very funny thing. See? Is anger against our body? I'm not sure. See, anger is of two types. One anger makes you work more. You see, you get angry and you decide, no, I'm not going to tolerate this. You see, and you take a morcha or you go and you fight with her or you give a strong letter. Means you are acting. So if the anger is promoting action from you, that anger is good. You follow. But the anger which causes frustration, anger and then I can't do anything, then that's a negative. So all those negative feelings are bad. The idea of telling heart people don't get angry is silly. The simplest word is silly. See? Don't get angry is correct. That means don't suppress anger. I hope you understand what I'm saying. If you get angry and don't express it, that is not getting angry. That is worse. But if you learn to tolerate and decide, okay, I forget it. The wife keeps on nagging, you see, and you get angry. After a while you decide, okay, it's no use getting angry. So you really don't get angry. I hope you have understood. If you really don't get angry, that's the ideal thing. That you will learn to react fully, then that is excellent. But if you are getting angry, then better blast, you see, because that relieves your tension. So if you get angry, shout, get rid of it and sleep. Ideal. So anger, I'm not so sure whether it is actually. The anger which goes you to work, goes to push yourself to more action is good. See, it is healthy. But the anger which causes frustration, you see, feeling of helplessness is bad. So anything that causes frustration or this, etc., is bad. And therefore, you must control your behavior in a way, see, to avoid these negative feelings. And you must try to develop all positive feelings that, okay, I can do something. Now, how to do it? It's all easy to say, but how do you do it? Then there are some few simple things. The most important is time management, and I may put it as ambition management. The word used is cognitive dissonance or something. Forget it, you see. Cognitive dissonance, that means I think that this should happen, that should happen, or I must do, and then you can't do. See, the gap becomes big between your expectation and your capacity. Now, this can affect even children. I'm coming to some of the day-to-day things, for instance. If you tell your, see, if your son or brother or somebody, you want him to get 90% marks because you want him to go to medical or engineering or some electronics and so on. Now, how much should you go? If a boy for SSC and 12th standard, if he works 6 hours, 10 hours, see, and gets 90%, while another boy who works 4 hours, 3 to 4 hours, see, and the third boy who works just 1 to 2 hours, see, you understand? Now, 3 to 4 hours, I would say, is a rather compatible thing. Whatever you want to achieve, I'm just taking one example, whatever you want to achieve must be part of your daily routine. You can't work 12 hours a day to achieve a small thing. So if the boy is made to work 6 hours, 10 hours and 12 hours, and then he gets 90%, then by the time he goes to that engineering or whatever, or when he goes for a job, see, I used to tell my students that what is this examination? Examination is nothing. See, afterwards you have to face life. That's a bigger exercise. You see, very tough. So, if you get frightened with that exam, and if you have to work so much, what will you do afterwards? So I don't want you to do so much. You must play. You must work. You must do some household work. And you must study. See, that is the maximum, see, that you can do. So when parents put some student to very hard work, you see, and he scores, he is under tension. See, he is doing abnormally more. The person who is doing just good average is excellent. The person who is doing just this much is very clever, actually, extremely clever. But he is not putting his full efforts. That means he is capable of rising to even 95%. If he was to put that much adequate effort, he is capable. He may not score, but afterwards such a student will shine in his life because he has the capacity. Or he may live happily at a low level.